It's going to be run a little bit different. So the content behind this is hopefully going to empower you guys into making good choices. So at the end of the day, rather than just writing up a plan and handing it to you without actually having any sort of buy-in or having any sort of understanding of the reasons why that we're actually eating or we need to eat or why we're eating or we're not getting the results that we're looking for. It can be a number of different things. So it can be the timing that you're eating the food, the type of food that you're eating. You know, you might have a 5-star health rating on something, but it's not necessarily 5-star. Then things that have low health ratings on them doesn't necessarily reflect how bad it is. Prime example is maybe say Up and Goes. I've seen you smash like 6 of them. So Up and Goes, I think that's got a 5-star health rating, but you'll have a look at coconut oil. Coconut oil has a 0 or 1-star health rating. Coconut oil is probably one of the best oils you can do and use for cooking. Because, I mean, olive oil is fantastic, but as soon as you heat it, it actually changes its chemical compound and actually changes the type of fat that it is. Where the coconut oil has a high, like it doesn't change its chemical compound when it's heated. So yes, it has a higher caloric value, but the calories are much, much better for you. But we're going to go into a little bit about fats and what type of fats are and why we actually do need fats and how it actually helps with our vitamins and minerals as well. But before I go off track, this is why I use slides to keep me on track, otherwise I run. So what are we here for today? We're here for a nutritional seminar. So We've got the food pyramid here. So we've got veggies, we've got fruits, we've got whole grains, we've got fish, we've got dairy, we've got meat. Me and Will went back and forth a little bit about this one, about a few different nutritional pyramids and what we believe. So essentially, yep, meats are great to have up there, but you want them to be a staple. Eggs and dairies, fish, whole grains, fruits and vegetables. So I'll unpackage that a little bit because it can be opened into interpretation quite a fair bit. So when we're talking fruit, we're talking whole fruit. We're not talking blended fruit. But first things first, what we're going to cover today. So we're going to cover carbohydrates, we're going to cover proteins, we're going to cover fats, we're going to cover vitamins and minerals. After that, we're going to throw over to Will. Will's going to go over enzymes and how they affect your digestional health. And then we're also going to go into low kilojoule diets, what is metabolism, how it affects you, what is a resting metabolic rate, those little things that are the big picture. So this is going to be how food actually works inside your body, then how it actually works in the real world. And then we're also going to, right at the end, hopefully come over about behavioral changes. Because I mean, that's the biggest point, is being able to make these behavioral changes. Hopefully this will give you the information to empower you, but then it's about making those changes yourself, all right? All right, first thing, carbohydrates. So we've got glucose, and then we've also got sucrose, two different types of carbohydrates. So most people know them as simple or complex carbohydrates. So your glucose, your simple carbohydrates, they're absorbed immediately. So they're absorbed immediately in your mouth. That's why when you do have your simple carbohydrates, they give you a good sugar pick-me-up. So they're ready to go. Now, they're absorbed really quickly into the system. That's why it's going to give you that big lift. But it absorbs quick. It also gets out of your body very, very quickly. But when you've got sucrose, lactose, and starches, so they're your complex carbohydrates. They're the ones that take a little bit longer to digest, and they're actually digested in the energy sources through the small intestine. So rather than having that energy absorbed through here, it takes its time to come through into your intestinal tract. So don't worry too much. We're going to go over and we're going to show you guys what are simple, what are complex carbohydrates, and where they sit on the spectrum. Alrighty, so moving along to the GI index. So who is, has anyone heard of the GI index? High GI and low GI foods? Alrighty, so I mean, this is a fantastic graph. So we've got high GI foods, and we've got low GI foods, and then we've got the simple and also the complex carbohydrates. So we can see what it does to our blood glucose levels, so the sugar that's in our blood. So yes, we do need that, but we see that, bang, it peaks about 45 minutes, and then we crash back down. Where the low GI foods have that slower release simply because it takes that longer and it's absorbed through the intestines, and also that's where that digestive health and having good, you know, I don't like saying the word gut, but gut health. So having really, really good gut health to help you absorb the carbohydrates throughout the day. Probably the best real world solution that, real world thing that I can actually throw your way is the 3 o'clock fuzzies. So at 3 o'clock, what do? Generally, we either reach for a Bicky or a coffee. We chuck maybe a couple of sugars in there, or we have a Bicky. Yes, that gives us a pick-me-up. Yeah, we're feeling a little bit better, but within 45 minutes, so before 4 o'clock goes around, bang, we've crashed right back down. So our metabolism does the same thing. Bang, comes back up, goes back down. Where if we made a different choice at that particular time, say, when I was working in an office, used to just have brown rice and tuna. So that means I had sitting there my complex carbohydrates plus my protein, and it was a really, really good get out of jail free card. So if I was feeling hungry, I would then eat that, and then it would generally push me through to the next stage of the day, especially for you guys who do afternoon CrossFit sessions. So you guys do need energy. If your last meal was at 12 o'clock and then you're training at 6 o'clock or 5:30, what are you using for energy? Like, you need energy in the system, alrighty? Now we're gonna go on to what foods are actually in the GI. So what is low and what is high GI foods? So we see there we've got on the low end of the spectrum, brown rice, that's wild rice. Never had that myself. Then we're getting up into our whites. We're getting up into our white rice. So that ends up being coming up to the high end. So that's the medium to the higher end of the GI levels. So if we have a look at the difference between brown and white rice, can you see a bit better up there? Alright, probably not. So, we've got our, We've got brown rice at 27, pretty good. Then we've also got our white rice at 64. So that's our GI index, alright? So when we're making those choices between what we actually want to eat or what carbohydrates we want to actually eat, the difference between white rice and brown rice, one's going to peak and give you that big pick-me-up, and then one's going to give you that slow release that's going to give you the energy throughout the day. Vegetables, this was actually quite a surprise to me because I actually eat quite a fair bit of it. Cooked carrot. Cooked carrot's at 39, but then we've got broccoli down there at 15. So they're those different types of choices. So there is this myth that carbohydrates is purely from starch. As we can see here, we can get carbohydrates from our veggies. So when you have someone coming up to you and saying, oh, I'm on a zero carb diet, they don't know what a carb is, essentially. If you're on a zero carb diet, you would probably have maybe about, I'd give you probably about 3 to 4 hours to live. at the end of the day, the only time that they put people through that is from massive amounts of surgery they need to regulate it in a hospital. So, yeah, as we can see, carbohydrates are absolutely everywhere. It's the type of carbs that we're going to go. Fruit as well, fruit's in there. So we've got watermelon tipping the scales at 72, but then we've got apples in there at 38. So having a look at those differences in those carbohydrates, you've got broccoli at 15, you've got apples in there starting at 38, so they do have that higher amount. So low-fat yogurt, 14, pretty awesome. Whole milk, 27. You've got ice cream tipping over the scales there at 61, so that's not validation to go out there and smash ice cream. We're going to paint the big picture. We're just not looking stroke by stroke, okay? So it's going to be the big picture. All right, peanuts, peanuts, fantastic. Low GI levels, high protein levels. Baked potato, tipping out there at 55. Black eye beans. Not even really too sure what they are. But yeah, all right. So we're moving on to the next stage. How does it react and how does it go over in our body? So once the carbohydrates are broken down into glucose, it is then goes through your digestive system, so through your gut. The glucose is then absorbed around the capillaries, around your system, surrounding your small intestine. So you've got your small intestine, you've got little things that sit there, that's what grabs onto and that's what helps the absorption. So if we've got, you know, throughout that gut health, we've got really, really good that we can break down the carbohydrates well. We can absorb the nutrients in our foods much, much better. So then glucose is then goes into the bloodstream. So once it goes into the bloodstream, it's stored in either your liver, then it's also in skeletal muscle, so in there. And once the, the stores in your muscles are actually full, it just sits there. So this is where eating the, not overeating and the timing of eating carbohydrates comes into play, so portion sizing. And also when you're actually eating. So once our skeletal muscle, so once our muscles have had their stores full, because there's only a certain amount the body can hold on to. So once that's full, what's gonna end up happening is it just ends up being converted into triglycerides or fat. So that ends up sitting in your body. So then your blood glucose goes to use it for fueling your central nervous system. Once again, I'm brushing upon the 3 o'clock fuzzies. So if I have a white sandwich at lunch, and then I'm feeling and cognitively, or I can't think straight, I'm sitting there at my computer, I'm doing my day-to-day task, and I can't put things together. Maybe you've maybe seen me at the end of a four class session where all of a sudden my food's gone for the day because I've been on the floor for 4 hours, and sometimes I get the classes mixed up and I'll call out maybe the 4:30 or the 5:30 class and give them the wrong names. Or I'll call a hang power snatch, a hang clean or something like that. Simply because I've used all my, all my energy stores, so my carbohydrate energy stores, and my central nervous system's just struggling just that little bit. But yes, so it is used to fuel your central nervous system, all right? So this is, you do need carbohydrates in your life. It is there to fuel how you think and how you move, and also for muscle contraction. We'll go on to proteins and how proteins will actually work in your system as well. So everything else there is pretty sciencey that I'm not just going to brush upon because I don't see a huge amount of value into that. So what we'll do, this will be available for you guys online so you guys can review it. And if you are interested, delve a little bit deeper down that rabbit hole. So, good carbs, complex, harder to digest, burning being done through the digestive system, keeps you fuller for longer, natural sugars, doesn't spike blood levels, used for energy, low glycogen, helps you lose fat. Cool. So, all that stuff I just went through, nice, broken down in one slide. Simple carbohydrates, digest immediately, don't get burns in the digestive system and get stored. Makes you hungry sooner. Makes you crash. There's that 3 o'clock fuzzies I keep going on about. Causes sugar cravings and addictions. Stored as fat. Pretty much there. I can go on for a lot longer, but I'll let you guys read that slide yourself. So, key take-home messages. What's the role of carbohydrates? Provides energy. Simple carbohydrates, sugars like glucose, fructose, sucrose, and lactose. Probably not going to remember that, don't worry too much about that. Complex carbohydrates like starches are made up of sugar molecules that are joined together. Cool. Not really sure if they're the best take-home messages I've ever put in a slide, but that's what it is. Alright? Okay. I think I just I probably should have thought about that one just a little bit. Proteins, okay. Proteins. Proteins are broken down in your digestive system and then turned into amino acids. Probably heard about amino acids. Supplement companies do sell them quite a fair bit. There is quite a bit of value in those different types, especially if we simply can't get whole foods. We need to have pretty much the building blocks of what protein are, especially if we've done a massive strength session, our bodies, screaming out for proteins to help repair our muscles. And that leads straight into my next point, that it's made for the growth of muscles, skins, organs, blood cells, and also enzymes as well. So you need to have a good amount of amino acids in your systems to actually help create enzymes as well. Helps repair and replenish skeletal muscles, so your muscles that grow. Amino acids, can be used for energy in extreme circumstances. Now, this is when people have really low carbohydrates diets. So, yes, protein can be used for energy. But where do we get that protein? It's not the protein that you, and it's not the carbs we put, protein we put in our mouths. It's the protein we've got in our muscles. All right? So, if we go into a stage of starvation, to fuel the central nervous system, the body will then break down skeletal muscle or your muscles into protein and amino acids that are called ketone bodies. So this is how the body will simply put itself into that survival state to hold on and to be used as energy. Now that's pretty much when you're starting to get hungry. So essentially that food that you're putting in your mouth is not being used for energy if you just got protein with it. Your muscles end up breaking down because it'll break that down first. The less muscles that we have and the less muscular structure we have, the lower our resting metabolic rate is. Don't worry too much, I'm going to go on about what a metabolic rate is in a later slide. So there's a little note that I want you guys to think of is if I'm feeling hungry, my body will break down protein, but it will break down the protein that I've already spent all that time turning it into our gains and our muscles and leaving me with less calories to burn. All right. Let's have a look at where we actually get protein from. So, we actually get, and the high amounts of protein. So we see right here, if you're vegetarian, this is probably, it's okay to be vegetarian and vegan, but this slide probably doesn't reflect that. So, the amount of protein per 100 grams worth of food. So we've got chicken in there at 31 grams, we've got tuna there at 29 grams, we've got 28 there for beef, and we've got some eggs tipping in there at 12 grams. We've also got, people will also say, yes, mushrooms are a great source of protein, but per 100 grams you get 2.5 grams worth of protein. So yeah, you've got to eat a lot of mushrooms to get the same, to get 31 grams worth of chicken. Avocado, 2 grams worth of protein. Cauliflower, 2 grams worth of protein. Tofu, 8 grams, yum. Then we've got almonds. Almonds with 21 grams. So that's a pretty good choice. We've got peanut butter there, sitting there at 25 grams. Once again, another really, really good choice. So they're the types of things, and hopefully from this particular slide that you'll be able to have a look at, that you'll be able to make those choices. Key take-home messages, protein is not used for energy, only in dire states, and it's used for function of regeneration of muscle and tissue for your organs. Alrighty. Protein is also made up of hundreds and thousands of small units called amino acids. Protein is used to build and repair muscle tissue as well. So, if you're traveling all day and you simply can't have food with you, like, you know, I wouldn't suggest having amino acids or anything like that along those types of lines and to swap it out. But if you're, you know, driving around or if you're moving around throughout the day, you need to keep your metabolism going and you need to keep going, especially after big, you know, big sessions. Having some of those on hand is, you know, is great because then you're actually going to help them, help your body, use it to help repair your muscles. Alrighty. Fats are broken down into fatty acids throughout your digestive system. These molecules are then directly absorbed into your capillaries that surround the small intestine. Notice a reoccurring theme around here about how important that small intestine is. Every piece of information and every piece of food that we're talking about here happens in the small intestine. So this is a huge part about it. So comes into the lymph vessels, lymph nodes that are located around large capillaries. So the lymph system is your body's immune system, essentially. So that's the thing that helps regulate, helps fight bacteria in your body. So keeping you healthy. Completely off topic, but your lymph system does not have its own pump, okay? So our cardiovascular system has a heart pumping blood around, pumping it all around. Our lymph system, or our body's immune system, doesn't have that. The way it pumps around is through muscle tissue and muscle contraction. So our muscles will help pump it around. That's why we tell you to go for recovery runs. So after a workout, if you go sit there, bang, all that, you've just absolutely wrecked your muscles, you've got so much damage that's happened. When I say damage, I don't want that to be a negative thing. It's great. Damaging muscle helps you repair it. But you want to do recovery sort of stuff, so that's where doing a cool down, comes into it. Unfortunately, we only get an hour with you guys, so if you guys go for a recovery run, that'll help flush the system. That's why sometimes after a big workout, rather than sitting there on the bed and feeling sorry for yourself, actually getting up and going for a run, you will feel better. I will guarantee you that every day of the week, that you will feel better because you will flush all those toxins out of your body. Alrighty, fatty acids can be stored into fat cells. Now, let's go on to different types of fats. So we've got saturated fats, we've got monounsaturated fats, we've got polyunsaturated fats? Yes, polyunsaturated fats, and then we've got trans fats. So, this light's fantastic because it's a green to red light. So where do we find saturated fats? Milk, meat, eggs, butter, cheese. Then we've also got monounsaturated fats, but this heated up to a high level ends up turning into this. Okay? That's why it's fantastic to have coconut oil. So coconut oil is there. It does have a high caloric value to it, so calorie value, how many calories are worth. But when it's actually heated, it maintains in the monounsaturated fat rather than moving over here into trans fats. Alrighty? Little bit of thing that isn't in the slide for the viewers at home. Alrighty, omega-6s, vegetable oil, sunflower seeds, sunflower, canola, peanuts, and then we've also got the trans fats, which are, well, we've got cheese, processed foods, snacky foods, and all that sort of stuff. So all the good stuff that's bad for you. Alrighty, so they're the types of fats. So now linking to why fats are important. So vitamins need fats to grab onto, to transfer through the system, alright? So, soluble fats, A, D, E, and K. So you'll go out and you'll buy a Centrum, and you'll take it, you're like, oh, this is fantastic, I'm getting my vitamins in, this is fantastic, alright, no worries. I may go to the bathroom and then my waste that I put out there is of a very yellow colour. Okay, that's a little bit strange, because it hasn't been absorbed into your body, because it hasn't, everything that's actually then come through hasn't grabbed onto there and then hasn't been dissolved through that small intestine, alright? So yeah, those are the ones that actually need fat to actually bind to actually then to be absorbed throughout your entire body. Fat stores, taking supplements, soluble, yeah, that's pretty much just exactly what I just said. Most soluble vitamins will be easily absorbed into the capillaries. Alright, this is a great chart of, this will be actually great to see at home. So, vitamin A, how much you should have for your daily intake, what effects does it have? So vitamin A is skin, bones, vision, and hair. Where do you find it? Liver, yum. Carrot, sweet potato, vitamin D, bones, immunity system, that's found in fatty fish such as, I don't know if you've ever eaten catfish, but salmon and eggs, vitamin E, skin, vision, hair, once again. So I won't read that one out for you, it's a little bit hard to see up there, but that's a great little chart to actually find out where you can actually get different vitamins and where you're actually feeling. So if you do go to a GP and they say you've got low vitamin E, vitamin C levels, or vitamin D levels because you're not getting enough sun, this is a great sign to say, okay, well, let's have a look at what types of food that I'm eating. Cool, where can I get that naturally? And if I can't get it naturally, you know, what am I actually going to take? Cool, am I actually, so if I can't get it naturally, alright, so I absolutely hate fish. Well, not me personally, but a lot of people hate fish. They don't want to eat it. So then if I take, cool, I'll get my Centrum or I'll take this. If I'm not having that, fat that's actually found in fish to help bind onto it, it's pretty much just going to get put through into waste. Alrighty, cool. Alrighty, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to throw over to Will. Now Will's going to talk about enzymes and how enzymes actually affect gut health. So I'll give the floor to Will.
So, enzymes, this is a big focus which I personally focus on because when I first started eating foods and kind of going to the gym about a year and a half, 2 years ago, I'd eat a lot of food, not knowing what I was putting into my body, like I'd be like, man, pasta, like, I don't know if you guys know Phil Heath or like Arnold Schwarzenegger, but I just like look at them and be like, shit, they're big, I want to get like them. So I just try to like mimic what they're eating, not knowing what I was putting into my body. So enzymes actually help you break down the food. So a good way to put this is, does anyone have kids here at all? Yeah, so you know when you give them, say I've got your kid and I give him a Coke, or a Coke, like Coca-Cola drink. they get really bouncy and they're like ready to go, they're ready to do something, they're ready to go, and they're ready to, I don't know, go play in the park, do whatever, like they're hard to control. And that's because when you're a kid, your enzymes are just pumping through your body and you've got a lot of enzymes going through yourself. So you can break down food really easily, break it down into the simplest form and use it as quick as you can. That's why kids are so energetic, because they can break down all their foods really quick, they can just smash and they kick on. But as we age, our enzymes get less and less, and our foods, we've got 7.5 billion people on this planet, we cannot. There is no such thing as like all organic food out there anymore. Like your bananas, your apples, they've lost like something ridiculous in nutritional value. I think it's like 90% or something like that over the past 100 years. Because it's all grown now in depleted soil. And when you think about it, you've got 7.5 billion people to feed. Say we all eat an apple a day, there is no way we are growing 7.5 billion apples every day. Like, it's just not doable. Anyway. Our food should consist of enzymes in it, but it doesn't anymore. But when you're a kid, it doesn't matter. So, because you've got your enzymes coming through. But when you're an adult, you start to, you slow down a bit, and your enzymes don't actually pump through your body. So, and then your food should have enzymes in it, but because it's so depleted, it doesn't. So what we do is we can supplement into enzymes, or we can just try and pick foods and eat more naturally. So like meat, that has hardly any enzymes in it. Why? Because it's frozen. Same as fruit and veg and things like that. They're all frozen, packaged for like, you know, a couple of months and then sent through. Like I went to I live up in the Adelaide Hills. I don't know if you guys know what that is around here. But, nice area. If you ever want to go to Harndorf, I would suggest it. So I went to primary school with a guy who actually, his dad owns a big company up there that sell cherries, apples, and strawberries. And we were just getting a tour through, and one of the girls there was like, yeah, these are the apples, and I think it was like August, and she's like, yeah, they've been here since January, and they've just been sat frozen, and they'll be the ones that you get in your supermarket these days. So food is actually snap frozen. Like, and I didn't believe it when I first heard that, and then I saw it, and I was like, shit, like it's legit. So enzymes are really important to help break down your food. So that's why as well when you, what else would it be? If you ate a meal, you know, you feel really sluggish after eating a big meal, you're like, man, I feel really sluggish right now. It's because your body is trying to like break it down. So having enzymes actually help that and help get like, yeah, help break it down into its simplest form, like children do. So yeah, that's the basic thing of enzymes. That's pretty much all that I've really got for enzymes. Just helps you break down your food, really. We're not getting much of it. Through as we age, we get less of it. And so that's why you feel depleted and crappy most of the way through. And also, a lot of foods we eat, like ones which have been, you know, ones that say, oh, they've got all these antioxidants in them. Like a boost juice or something like that. Like they go on about how good it is. How healthy it is, but there's nothing in them, and when you put it in the blender, so when you actually blend things up, I don't know what the blending thing is, like it's complicated, but if you blend something up too much, it actually kills all the enzymes in it, so you're actually just breaking down the enzymes, so you're just putting it straight in your body, it's going straight through your system. And the other thing which I was going to quickly touch base on was just with, if you have a supplement, when I have a big night out, or when I used to have a big night out, we're all human, we all do it. You have a Barocca the next morning, or something, and so you have a Barocca, go to the toilet, and your urine's like fluoro yellow. And that is because it's literally just putting your vitamins straight in your mouth, and they come straight back out. So like, they did not get absorbed, like Brenden said before, because A, they don't have the fats to go on, and B, they don't have the enzymes to actually break down and take into your system. So they're not getting absorbed by the body and they're just going straight through. So that is why also it is great to read the label of your supplement, things like that, to actually get the enzymes blend, like the enzyme blend in each one. So, yeah, I hope I remember.
Awesome. Cool. Yeah, don't worry, we're going to brush a bit more on about blending juices. Because, yeah, the enzymes part I didn't know about, but we're going to go on to about the reason why fiber is completely taken out of that sort of stuff as well. Alright, but anyway, moving on. What is metabolism? It's a chemical process that occurs in all living organs in order to maintain life. Great, awesome story, Brenden. That's getting you up in the morning. Alright, so what is your resting metabolic rate? So your resting metabolic rate is pretty much the amount of calories that you need to move yourself over a period of time. So how much calories you need to burn in a day to live. So, okay, no worries. For how many calories I might need, 2,000 calories a day just to get through my day-to-day without going into, you know, ketosis or the starvation thing. Alrighty. Resting metabolic rate, I just come over that. So calories are then used for energy that we use throughout the day. Alright, so essentially your resting metabolic rate. Resting metabolic rate and what your metabolism is. So your metabolism is probably the best way to describe it is a fire. Okay, so your fire keeps burning and keeps burning and keeps burning. It needs to go out, but essentially it still needs to keep burning. So where is it going to get that energy from? So if I'm going into starvation mode, my fire keeps, okay, cool. I'm just going to keep going down and down and down. Well, I still need to find something. I still need to find something to keep this fire going, otherwise I die. So what will end up happening is I need to find different things to burn. So before we brushed upon a little bit about how your body goes into what's called ketosis and then breaking down protein to actually fuel your central nervous system. So everything else will shut down, but this thing up here will stay working for a long time. It's generally called a coma. Keeping the fire stoked. So what does this mean? This means eating small meals throughout the day. So constant, like eating, you know, 3 to 5 meals, well, minimum of 3, 5 meals a day. So constantly eating, you know, every three or so hours. So knowing, you know, it's great if you know what your metabolic rate is, that's awesome. If you're the type of person to sit there and count calories and all that, I'm not, absolutely not. I could not think of, anything more boring. But taking note and understanding what you're putting into your body and having a rough idea about where your protein is, cool, you know, I need to get about 30 grams worth of protein, you know, in per meal. Alright, so I know that that's 100 grams worth of chicken. If I'm doing meal prep, awesome, what am I going to do? I've got to make 5 days. Alright, I need 100 grams, 500 grams, and I just sight, put it in. It doesn't matter if one day is 110 grams, one day is 90. If you have to weigh every piece of meal and every piece of food that you have for making meal prep, man, that would suck. That would suck. No way.
Consuming as well.
Oh, it is. Yeah, I don't know. Like, my meal prep takes me probably about an hour and a half on a Sunday to set me up for the week. If I had to weigh everything, and at the end of the day, you end up citing it anyway. You end up being like, yeah, cool. Well, most of the time, you know the package. You're like, yeah, cool. I need about this. I need about this. I need about this. So, I mean, that's in an ideal world, okay? So that means if I'm doing the exact same thing day in, day out, I am going there and I am, okay, I am lifting the exact same amount of weights today, I am doing this, I am sitting at my chair for X amount of time and I'm doing this for X amount of time. But what happens if we have a longer workout? What happens if we have more chores in the yard? What happens if my caloric demand, so the amount of calories that I've burned in that day, are at a higher rate? Well, then I need more food. I'm not going to stand there and go, oh, well, I can only have 2,000 calories per day. It's like, well, I've actually done a fair bit today. I need food for fuel to eat. Once again, central nervous system going down. All right, so that's your resting metabolic rate. So how do we shake things up? So How do we have our metabolism going? So it's eating small food, so keeping that fire burning. We don't let the body go into starvation. So it's one of those things. It's if we eat, if we're hungry, we eat. But then we make good choices when we eat. So we're like, okay, you know, how much energy and how much more work am I going to do today? So
most common thing, and it's all right, my parents did exactly the same thing when I was a kid. You have a big pasta meal, you have a big rice meal, man, it feels so good. You're eating, man, all that, you know, lifts you up, you feel tired. Cool, I just ate that at 7 o'clock at night, and I'm going to bed at 9 o'clock. Cool. Where's all that fuel for energy gone? It's going to get stored into fat. So I'm making an incorrect choice at that time to have pasta for dinner. Yes, I love pasta. Yes, it makes you feel so good. I love the way it makes me feel. But I am then going to go to sleep and I'm going to sit on that for hopefully 8 hours. Not necessarily for everyone, but yeah, hopefully 8 hours. So essentially, that amount of time, especially if it's a simple carbohydrate that hasn't been burnt up in 45 minutes, it's going to happen. It's going to get chucked into your fat stores because all of a sudden, the body doesn't need it for energy. If I make a choice then to have that at 12 o'clock for my lunch meal, well then, white rice isn't, I would not recommend, but if it's the only thing you've got, yes. But if I have my brown rice, then it's going to take me to 3 o'clock. Cool, I know I've got a workout or I've got a session. Cool, I'm going to have a little bit more brown rice at that particular time. And that's going to take me through to dinner where I get my carbohydrates from my veggies and all those different types of things. Alrighty? If I'm not working out on a day, it's a rest day or something like that, I might say, okay, my 3 o'clock meal here, I'm going to get my sauce from there because I know I'm just going to go here, I'm going to go home, and then I'm going to go sit down in front of the TV. Okay, cool. That's completely fine. Or I'm going to go for a nice walk because Brenden would want you to do that. But I'm going to make a choice about the type of carbohydrates that I'm going to eat at that particular time. So it's different types of timing. So, okay, cool. Once again, I'm going to have my veggies in and then I'm going to have veggies and protein for dinner. If you can get away with just eating veggies and veggies and bananas and all that sort of stuff and not having meat, I eat a lot of meat. That's why I like with meat as well, your body needs to be able to digest it. So otherwise it just sits there and it rots in your system. So for myself, I need to go on what's called the FODMAP diet, or what's called irritable bowel syndrome. So that means my small intestine is quite sensitive. So that means it goes haywire and it doesn't want to absorb and it gets really disgusting, it's not great, if I eat certain foods and it irritates it. So it's really hard for gut health. So that's probably one of the reasons why I talk about it quite a fair bit, because I've experienced it my whole life and I hadn't actually been diagnosed until I was 29 years old. So not understanding and not knowing, making poor food choices for so long, it made me hold on to body fat. It also made life pretty bad. Also, you're working out, you're doing all the right things, why am I still tired? It's because I'm not absorbing things. And I've been there, man, I've been there so tired, and I've slogged it out in the gym, I'm eating well, like, everything's ticking in. You know, where is this cell? Where's my energy levels? Where is this? It wasn't from what I was actually doing. I made a small behavioral change in my diet and I had more energy. So you guys are all here. You guys have first started to make that first behavioral change. I won't bang on too much about behavioral change. We'll go into that a little bit later. Alrighty, moving straight along. Low kilojoule diets. I've already brushed upon this body survival technique, cutting out kilojoules. And calories to essentially lose fat. I'm pretty much just gonna say no, man, don't work. So I'm cutting out calories and cutting calories. My metabolism at the moment is, we'll just put a random number out there. We'll say 2,000 calories. So 2,000 calories, cool, I need to cut calories. All right, cool, I'm gonna cut calories to lose weight. Cool, I'll go down to 1,700 calories per day. Yeah, I'm gonna lose weight. What's gonna end up happening is my resting metabolic rate ends up becoming here, because it's, you're not going to constantly, you know, by eating this amount of calories and cutting your caloric output, it doesn't last forever, man. It lasts for about 6 weeks if you're lucky, because the body then adapts. The body does always adapt to the way your body is going. All right, so then what happens, and what ends up happening then? I have to go down to 15. It ends up creeping back up. I have to go down to 13. Back up. I have to go down to 12. I would not want to live off of 1,200 calories per day, man. That would be terrible. That would be disgusting. So that's the effect of a low kilojoule diet. Is yes, you'll get short-term results,
But at the end of the day, what for? Like, I mean, if you're doing a bodybuilding comp or something like that, and that is your sport, and you need to get lean, yep. And then you have to withstand the rigors of then reverse dieting, doing that correctly. But most of them, I don't know if you've ever seen a lot of the bodybuilders, but post-competition, they don't look too much like bodybuilders because they're living off of 1,000 calories, and then they can think, man, I want to eat everything that I want. And what ends up happening? All that hard work, those months and months worth of hard work just to get some photos and a medal around your neck. I mean, if that's your sport, that's cool, that's awesome. You know, the things people put themselves through in CrossFit, injury rates in CrossFit are much, much less than what football would be, but the rigors you put yourself playing football or basketball or anything like that, man, you get beat up, you get sore. But if that's your sport and you love it, well, that's awesome. If that's what motivates you and gets you out of bed, but what we're talking about here is good quality of life and actually having a good quality of life and for a long period. Alrighty, how to increase your resting metabolic rate. So how to actually end up having more calories per day. Alright, so do high intensity interval training. Now, this isn't me trying to sell you CrossFit. This is just what the documents will say. Especially if you look up, what's the name? Oh wow, mental blank. Gland that's here.
Oh, adrenal.
Adrenal, no, thyroid. Yeah. Hypothyroid, so low thyroid. You know what the exercise prescription written by clinical exercises is for helping out a low thyroid to manage your and re-regulating your hormones? It's strength training by high intensity interval training. So I don't want you guys to think this is a sell for CrossFit, but at the end of the day, it'd be the same thing. Like wherever you get it from, and as long as you do a strength component, bang, and then you do some sort of, we call it metabolic conditioning or HIIT training or, you know, 30 seconds on Tabata, whatever it is, that's a great recipe for success. Also, what that's going to do is it's going to help regulate your hormones. When your hormones are regulated, that's going to help out with absolutely everything. Alrighty, big one for me, getting adequate sleep, 8 hours a night. Hard, I know. Performing weights training, obviously. The leaner muscle mass that we're gonna have, the bigger the, well, when we say muscle, you know, for our females in here, doing resistance training is not gonna make you huge. I'm sorry, but you're never gonna lift that amount of weights. Like, you're never gonna train that hard. A lot of people will come in and they'll be like, oh, well, I like CrossFit, but I won't wanna look at the, don't wanna look like the girls from the CrossFit games. Yeah, that's not gonna happen. That's simply not going to happen. If you're lifting weights for 6 hours a day and you're in here like an absolute gym rat, those girls absolutely are some of the most dedicated athletes you'll ever see here in your entire lives. In saying that, guys, we aren't going to look like Rich Froning from doing an hour a day. Yes, we're going to look a little bit leaner. Yes, we're going to, you know, increase our metabolic rate. We're going to feel better about ourselves. We're going to have better moods as well. We're going to sleep better from exercise, but at the end of the day, if you want to look like that, man, you gotta be training 6-7 hours a day. I mean, cool, if you think you're gonna go to the games, that's awesome, cool. I'll help you get there. Maybe, not really. But or might have a go, but if you've got the dedication to work that much, the sky's the limit. Alright, eat protein. Absolutely, eat protein, because if we do not repair our muscles, they're not gonna grow. Same way, if we have that plant sitting there in our lounge room, we don't get it water and sunlight, it dies. Eat more plant-based foods, so things that grow out of the ground. The quality of plant, you know, based foods has diminished, as Will talked about. Unfortunately, the world we live in at the moment is that it's pretty hard to actually get decent quality food, but it's better than smashing down Snickers. All right, drink water. Drink water 4 or 5 times a week. So, cravings. Oh boy, do I get cravings. I am an absolute sucker for chocolate. It's terrible. Like I can't have refined sugar in my house because I will just smash it. So, this chart's actually pretty good. What sort of cravings you had? What does it mean? Magnesium levels down, so chocolate, magnesium. Where am I gonna get that? I'm gonna get it, nuts, seeds, veggies and fruit. Sugar cravings, there's a few different types of things there, but broccoli, grapes, fresh fruit. I always find almonds are really, really good. Eggs are great. If you've got a shop, having some boiled eggs sitting there in your fridge, That's going to be fantastic because you're going to eat some of them. Wow. That's reaching for that Freddo frog, all of a sudden you get good fats in your system, you're feeling full for longer. That ends up subsiding. Now, breads, pasta, and other simple carbohydrates. What are we going to get? High protein foods, meats, fatty fish, nuts, beans, chia seeds. Alright? So, like I brushed upon earlier, a carb meal is pretty damn good. Like some ravioli, some. Oh, I'm getting hungry just thinking about it. But, yeah, it's not the best choice. Oily foods, calcium, milk, cheese, green, all I'm saying about this side is give it a go. Give it a go. Say, man, I really want myself a pasta meal. Alright, cool. Well, I'm gonna eat myself, I'm gonna go have some tuna, and I'm gonna have, tuna is a pretty good choice if you can stomach tuna. I'm gonna have some beans, I'm gonna have some rice, I'm gonna make myself I don't know, I'm not a great chef, but something. Just chuck it in a bowl and just see where it goes. And see if that alleviates it. You guys might not be driving down the shops for that Snickers bar. Now, I'm not saying that from a negative point of view, because definitely I've been there. I'm a real bad sucker.
Also, another thing that I'll just add to that is that most people get food cravings around the same time, like every day. So for me, I get food cravings at like 4 to 5 every day. And what I do is I plan to eat at around 3:33 and have a bigger meal. So then I actually feel fuller and I don't get that craving. Because as soon as you eat something, you won't actually have the craving. It's just when you're hungry, you're like, man, like, mum buys, I don't know, chocolate or something, I'm just looking at it. And if I haven't had food, like, I'm a sucker for it. So, like, you have to have that idea in your head of when you're going to get hungry. And then before you get hungry, smash through some tuna and rice, and you'll get past that craving. You won't actually have it.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. I'm going to show you how.
Alright, cool.
Speak to you.
No worries. Alrighty. Well, so that, thanks for listening. We're going to go through. Alright, so now we're going to go through, question and answer. Alright, so probably with nutrition and food and everything, behavior change. There, in my opinion, there are four things to a healthy lifestyle. First one is fitness, second one is nutrition, third one is sleep, fourth is stress. Alright, what's the easiest intervention that you can possibly do out of any of them to start? It's an exercise intervention. Coming to the gym 3 times a week is easy. Really, like, I know it's hard, the workouts are hard, Murph's hard, but going to the gym, getting up and coming up and working out 3 times a week, man, that's easy. Nutrition, that's 24 hours a day. That makes things a little bit harder. Sleep. That makes things for hard, especially if we're working shift work, if we're working around shit. That's pretty hard to actually get a hold of. Stress levels. Managing your stress. Man, how do you manage your stress? How do you manage a stress situation? I want to have less stress in my life. Man, I'll tell you, if you want less stress in your life, manage the 3 first and the other one will come. Alright? So, excellent. You guys are here. You're working out, you're at a seminar, it's great. You've made that first intervention for that first behavioral change. Then now you become accustomed to behavioral changes. Now what we need to do to further your results is you make the second behavioral change. So you make that second behavioral change. And I'm not saying I'm going to have a look at my entire diet and I'm going to say, well, I'm not going to do this, this, and this. Make one change. What am I going to do today? What am I going to do today, this week, that it's going to help improve my quality of life for the rest of it and have a longevity of life. Sleep, I could bang on for hours about the importance of sleep, why it makes you stressed if we've got bad sleep, the different stages of sleep, but I think we're probably going to do something on sleep later on because I think it's a huge thing, so I think we'll probably do an hour-long seminar just purely on that. But yes, so they're the behavioral changes. All right, any questions?
Talking about enzymes and how we don't have them anymore. Like, where do you get them from?
So I supplement them. So I just get them off a cutting to actually work with, so I took a while to actually find it. The only thing with enzymes is they're more expensive because they're like, so if you go to a chemist, they're expensive to produce, and the chemist is going to make profit off of them. So you go to a chemist and you try and find them, they're going to be pretty dear. So I get mine online. I can, like, it's from Your Health, that bottle that I got just there, yourhealth.com. And I get mine off there, they're called digestive enzymes. I also have one with a bigger meal. And a lot of people ask me, like, oh, so why would I have them? It's going to get rid of all the enzymes that my body producing. Because your body does produce some, just not enough to break down your food. Like a bigger meal won't break it down. So what I say is, look, we're just mimicking like nature, as in we have, you know, like we're doing what nature was doing 100 years ago, which it isn't doing anymore. So that's basically it. That's what I feel.